Well, let's read Matthew chapter 6. Let's pick it up in verse 9, where we left off last week. Verse 9, chapter 6 of Matthew. In this manner, therefore, pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this evening. We have to come before you and have your word open before us. We pray, as we always pray, not my word, but your word would be spoken in this place. That we would become greater disciples of you, Jesus, allowing you to rule and reign in every realm of our life. Lord, we thank you for letting us just be together moments ago in worship and before that and just having some great dinner together. Thank you again, as Pastor Lars mentioned, seeing all the kids running around church, the junior highers, the high schoolers. I just love that this is a place, this is a church filled with life, that this is a beacon that people are drawn to come and to hear your word. So we pray for high school, we pray for junior high, we pray for the kids area tonight. You would pour your spirit upon them. And we pray for us, Father, would you come speak to us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Awesome. Well, I don't know if you've ever been in a situation where you are drowning and you've had to call out for a lifeguard. I remember one time when I was younger, we were at a beach. And my brother and I were kind of fooling around. We were kind of way far out, and we weren't in need of a lifeguard, but the lifeguard thought we were, and he came out to rescue us. And you know, I started thinking about it. You know, is there really a wrong way to cry out for help for a lifeguard? Right? Is there like a wrong way to do it? Is there a right way to cry out? I mean, there's not really, right? You wouldn't really say, well, you know, and Corey actually is a lifeguard, Corey, so I don't know, maybe you have more information. Of course, Corey's a lifeguard at the swim club, a place full of swimmers. But I'm glad that you're there in case swimmers forget how to swim and you can save them. Just kidding. I love you, Corey. There's no wrong or right way to call out for a lifeguard. Well, in some instances, when we think about prayer, is there like a wrong way to pray? Is there a wrong way to cry out to God? Is there a wrong way to scream for help? Is there a wrong way to say, Father, please come and save me? I don't think there really is a wrong way to pray. But this evening, we come into a portion of Scripture that the Lord describes as, hey, when you pray, pray it in such a way. Pray in this manner, in this pattern. And what I want us to see and been praying for us this evening is not that we would take the Lord's Prayer and use it as like this mechanical tool to just like, you know, memorize, which we're gonna do it in a second, actually, because we were told to memorize it last week. So get ready for that. But not that we should just memorize it and just like make it just be something that we just say as a machine. But I want us to use it and see it tonight as two things. One, as a guide, that it would be a way where we can kind of look through and have it in our hearts and it can help guide and navigate us as we pray. But I also want to see it as a gateway, that as we tonight, I pray, learn more about the Lord's Prayer, it would be a gate. It would be this way where we could kind of open the door to different avenues, different compartments of how we can pray. The Lord's Prayer is we could be praying it for infinity. I mean, it's incredible what we have before us this evening. So I want to see it as a guide and as a gate. As a guide to help navigate us and as a gate to open us up even into greater ways in our prayer life. Now, before we kind of continue to get in, Pastor David did ask us to memorize this. Now, maybe some of you are thinking about your old Catholic days and saying Our Fathers, you know, 57 times or whatever, but we're going to try it. Now, I do have it up on PowerPoint. All right, so if you want to memorize it, close your eyes, but I don't want to make anybody feel too bad. Next week, if we say it again, we'll have no PowerPoint. You have to just say it from your heart, okay? Now, I grew up, my dad taught it to me in the King James Version, so it's been very hard to not say it King James Version-ish, but I'm going to try my best, okay? So are you ready? We have it on the thing, but if you don't want to do it, look a different way, okay? All right, ready, set, go. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Something, yeah? From the evil, yes, yeah. Kingdom and the power.
Okay, that's pretty good. That's pretty good. I messed up too. That was good. That was excellent. Man, it's hard. I kept thinking thy. And trespass. I learned trespasses, you know. Anyway.
Well, tonight what we're going to look at is two different things. I believe the Lord's Prayer, which again really is the disciples' prayer. It's a prayer that Jesus instructs us to pray. It consists of two different parts. And in each part, we're going to have 3 points. So there's two sections with 3 points, which equals a total of 6 points, which you think, man, this is too many points already. Get me out of here. We're going to go through it pretty quickly. And again, we're going to leave lots of gems, lots of nuggets on the pages. We can't go through everything. But the first section really deals with praise toward God. And the second section deals with petitions for man. So the first part is talking about God. The second part is talking about man. And what I want us to see first is this. Our relationship described, all right? Our relationship described. Let's look at this first phrase. Our Father in heaven. Our Father in heaven. Relationship described. You can't help but be struck by the way Jesus begins this prayer. Our Father in heaven. Now, that would have, I mean, you got to... This is something we know so well. We have it memorized. We've heard it so many times. It's hard to kind of hear it again for the first time. But if you will, just try to think about the disciples. Jesus is saying, hey, this is how you're supposed to pray, our Father. That first phrase, it would have blown their mind. The Hebrew mind never thought about God as Father. In fact, in the Old Testament, there's only about 7 times where God is even kind of referenced to as a Father. But when Jesus comes on the scene, over 70 times, Jesus will describe God as his Father. In the Hebrew mind, if you think about all the Hebrew names for God, El Shaddai, right, the mighty one, Elohim, the strong one, Yahweh, the great I Am, you know, all these names spoke of distance. And awe, and you might remember that the Hebrews, the Jews would even barely speak the name of God. They would never even write it down, his whole name. They would just say those 4 letters, YHWH. You know, they wouldn't even spell out his entire name, Yahweh. They would just barely pronounce it. They would barely, when they went in the temple, they would just keep their eyes closed. They wouldn't touch it. I mean, it was just like God was to be revered, and he was distant. So here's Jesus. Hey, guys, when you pray, I want you to start by saying, our Father. And it's easy for us to think about, but think about them. It would have just been totally a game changer for them. It describes this relationship. Father speaks of intimacy, right? Intimacy. We think about this phrase is wrapped up so much companionship. That the God of all creation, the creator of the universe, would desire to be called Father. I thought about this in Psalms chapter 8, verse 3. You might know this. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have ordained, what's man that you're mindful of him? Right? And the Son of Man that you should visit him. That the God of all creation would say, hey, you can call me Father. We're welcomed in his presence. You know, one of the things I want to teach my kids being here on church is sometimes when I'm up here, there's people that want to talk to me, and there's a couple people kind of waiting, and I tell my kids, hey, you can always cut in line. Right? It doesn't matter who. I don't care if it's Ginger, Hinchke, you know, I don't care who it is. You can always cut right in line, come right to me, because I'm your dad. And you're always welcome to come right to me. And that's this intimacy that Jesus is describing. Hey, when you pray, when you come before, it's like God saying his arms are wide open. You cut in line. There's this intimacy there. There's this companionship. There's this, the reason, of course, is because we've been forgiven. Now, as I was praying, I thought about this. I never thought about it this way, but you can't call him Father unless you are his child. You can't call him Father unless you're one of his children. And you're only one of his children if you've responded in faith to the work of his Son, Jesus Christ. And so this is not a prayer for everyone to pray, to be honest. This is a prayer for believers in Jesus Christ. Because not everyone can say, oh yeah, God's my father. No, no, no. He's your God. He's the God of all creation. He's only your father if you are his child. And you're only his child as you if you have surrendered your life into his lordship. And so this is really a thing for a believer to pray. I was thinking, you know, on the cross, Jesus Christ would cry out to his Father, my God, why have you forsaken me? So that you and I could cry out to God, you are my Father. That's the work upon the cross. It provides this intimacy now. We have this relationship described. Galatians 4, verse 4, but when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law to redeem those who were under the law that we might receive the adoption of sons, right? And because you are sons, God sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. So it's just an incredible beginning here, this relationship described. He is our Father. He has only not only forgiven us of our sin, but he has forgotten our sin as a father. It's not like God biologically can forget our sin, right? I mean, because he's God, but he is by volition. He volitionally, he forgets. He chooses to no longer remember our sin. He no longer counts our past against us and lets it alter or mar our current and present relationship. That's our Father. It's beautiful. Well, if our Father speaks of intimacy, our Father in heaven, heaven speaks of majesty. Of majesty. You see, heaven is a place where we are not. And our Father, he is a place, he is here with us where we are, and he's also where we are not. He is in heaven. And I think it's to remind us that he's like a father unlike anyone we know. He's the Father in heaven. He's not your earthly father. And I was thinking, no, I have a great dad, and maybe many of you have wonderful dads, but doesn't matter how great your dad is, our Heavenly Father outweighs him totally, right? Or maybe you're here this evening and your father was pretty strict. And what can happen is that we can take our earthly father and kind of see our Heavenly Father in that way. And so maybe your earthly father was strict. So maybe you just kind of always think about God as this father who's very strict that is always kind of wagging his finger at you. As this God that has these scales in his hand, balancing out your good and your bad, you know. Or maybe you had a father that was very uninvolved. And so you think, well, God doesn't really care. He's not really around. He doesn't really that interested in what goes on in my life. Maybe you didn't have a father at all. And so maybe you see God as this father that's totally absent and unaware. But Jesus says, when you pray, I want you to think about the relationship that you have. He's your Father, and he's in heaven. He's not like anybody you know. He'll never lie. He'll always show up. He never changes. His love pursues you relentlessly. He's the Father in heaven. I think we next see kind of this idea of not only our relationship described, but our role defined. Our role defined. Look at next verse 9. And then he says, Jesus says, when you pray like this, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name. Hallowed is such a weird word, right? It's kind of funny that in the NIV, which it's the goal of the NIV version is to make it like a little bit more like in today's language, they still use the word hallowed. You know, it's like that's the only word they could find. Hallowed means, right, to be set apart, to be holy. To be different. Hallowed be your name. It's this idea of Jesus saying, when you pray, Father, you are my Father in heaven, and I want your name to be hallowed. I want your name to be set apart. I want your name to be holy. Your name, not the actual name, but the name here represents the character of God, the nature of God, the reputation of God. Like for instance, you know, if you knew a company that had a great name, let's just say, for instance, Patagonia, right? Patagonia, Patagucci. Patagonia has this name of being a great company. You know, I would say, you know, you could maybe argue with me, perhaps, but
Patagonia, right? They're this company that makes incredible outdoor gear, outdoor clothing. And you could say, man, the name Patagonia signifies, right, the most advanced research ever of outdoor gear, you know. And it bears a stamp of just meticulous care, precision, you know. And it symbolizes ultimate reliability and dependability. It's got the highest degree of craftsmanship, you know. Patagonia, you put that jacket on, you're just feeling good. Well, we kind of understand that. Well, in the same principle, when Christ says, hey, when you pray, you ought to pray, Father, let your name be worthy, but let it be holy, let it be set apart. Let your name, your character, your reputation, it is of the highest quality. It's untarnished, it's unblemished, it is totally other. And when we pray that way, we're getting our eyes upon God. God, your name be set apart. Your name be honored. May it be revered and respected because of who you are. May your name and your person and your character be kept untarnished. May nothing be done to debase it or defame your name. That's how we ought to pray. Looking our eyes upon the Lord. Lord, you are our Father, and your name is to be holy. Now, how is the Father's name to be hallowed, to be made holy? Because it's certainly not holy in this world we live in now, right? I mean, do people look at and think about the character of God and think, wow, that is a reputation to uphold? No, man, people mock the name of God. They ridicule the name of God. They slander and they blasphemy and they curse the name of God, his character, his reputation. You see, his name to be hallowed, it is to be hallowed in our personal life. That's what I believe. Part of this prayer is saying, Lord, I want your name to be hallowed, and it's not happening in this world, so you know what? I'm gonna set your name apart. Right? Our very name, Christian, bears his mark. Right? We are little Christ. And so we go about this world bearing the Father's name. And so on one hand, in this prayer, Jesus is saying, hey, When you're praying, when you think about how you're living and what you're bringing to the Father, you are bringing a life that is to bear his name. And so I could ask myself, how am I doing? How are we doing lifting the name of Jesus high in our life? When I think about praying this prayer, I think about, whoa, Lord, is that something that I am doing? Am I hallowing your name? Am I making it holy? What's interesting in the world we live in, they are not going to do it, but man, they sure expect us to. You ever thought about that? How hard and under scrutiny the world looks at us as Christians? Like anything goes for them, but Christians, man, you better be perfect. Right? Even right now in my little neighborhood, we have a HOA, right, which just basically means bunch of rules. And right now, you know, I have two huge cars. I have a lot of kids, and so I have a huge Sequoia, I have a huge Suburban. And I just can't put them in my garage. I have like 15 strollers and like 87 bicycles and just clothes everywhere and like just Costco piles of food. And I can't fit two cars in my garage, so I want to park one in this little parking spot. Well, the rules go you have to first put two cars in the garage. And then you can put your third car in this little parking spot. Well, I don't have to. Anyway, I've been kind of written up a couple times, you know, I'll just let you know. And I was really getting mad. I was like, you know what, Lord, this is a way. Can this be a way that I hallow be your name? Is this a way? My neighbors know who I am. I got a big old Calvary sticker on the back of my truck, on my Suburban. I got a big old Safe and Sound sticker. I mean, I put the Easter sticker on there. You know, they know who I am. They know what I do. And I was like, man, you know, is this a way for me to hallow your name? To park my car 400 miles away from my house? Okay, unto Jesus, I will do it. Unto Jesus, I will park my car so far, because you know what? I want to hallow his name, and this is a way for me to do that, right? We know Matthew 5:16. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. And so Jesus is saying, when you pray, I want you to think about these things. He's your Father in heaven. This is this relationship that you have. There is this role displayed, right? This role defined.
We are to bear his name to the nations. And then it says, the last part of this part, this first section, his rule display. Then he says, verse 10, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So then Jesus is just really like, okay, when you pray, do this. Before you do anything, understand the relationship, understand your role, understand his rule should be displayed. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We could spend so much time on each one of these points, but we have to move through two quick thoughts: surrender and submission. Surrender, your kingdom come. When we pray that, when we pray, your kingdom come, what we're praying is in a sense two things. One thing we're praying is, Lord, one day your kingdom will come. Right? We believe that. One day, Jesus, you're coming back. And your kingdom's going to come, and Jesus, you're going to rule, and you're going to reign right here on earth. That's going to be incredible. That's going to happen one day. And so, Lord, come quickly, come quickly. Your kingdom come. But also what we're praying, when we pray your kingdom come, is, Father, right now, your kingdom come in my life, in my heart, right here today. You see, the kingdom is where the king is. Right, and Jesus would even say, hey, the kingdom is in you. And so when we pray your kingdom come, on one level, we're talking about Christ, come again. Thank you, please, Lord, come. Your kingdom come. Can't wait for it. But also, your kingdom come, Lord, right now, would you rule, your rule displayed in my life. See, the problem is that I want to be a king on the throne, right? I want to be my own king. I want to make my own decisions. I want to make my own way of living, and I want to direct myself. And so when Jesus says, hey, when you pray, get your heart right and say, Lord, no, not my kingdom. Not Nate on the throne of his heart. Not Nate driving his car and his life. No, your kingdom come. You're the king, so would you reign today, right here, right now? I relinquish the rule of my own life in order to allow God upon the throne instead. The idea here that Jesus is saying is that the King of Kings would so permeate your life that, in a sense, his kingdom is now. It's right here where you are. There's this idea of surrender. You're surrendering your rights over to him. And there's this idea of submission. Your kingdom come. Then Jesus says, then pray, your will be done. So this idea of submission, right? Jesus always did the will of the Father, always. I mean, even when he was a young kid, we hear about him going to the temple and his earthly parents saying, what are you doing? I'm about my Father's business. He always did the Lord's business. He was always in submission to his Heavenly Father. Now the problem is that we have a will of our own. You see, like two things are moving all the time. We have our own will and our own desire. And there's God's will and God's desire. And sometimes they're in harmony. And it's like, yeah, this is awesome, right? Most of the time, they're not. My will is over here, and God, I wish I could do two different things at the same time, right? It's like in confrontation. They're not in sync. They're not in harmony. And so this prayer, Christ says, hey, you pray, your kingdom come, your will be done. Lord, bend my will into sync with yours. Your will be done. I surrender over to you. You're the king, not me. And I submit to your rule. Let my dreams, my passions, my what I want, Lord, let it be in total sync with you, Jesus. And then that's really the secret of a Christian walk, right? Is allowing our will to be synced up with God's. And that's how Christ says, let's pray. Let your will be done. Let me be in alignment with you. You might say, well, what? I got some pretty good dreams. You know, my will is pretty good. You ever been to a place, a restaurant, where it's your first time, and you're going with someone that's been there before. I mean, just make a suggestion. You should allow them to order, right? You've never been there before. You don't know what's good. You don't know what's bad. And you look at the other person. They know the menu, like going with the dollars out there. Man, they know so many things. They know so many menus. It's great to go eat with them. They know places. And so I said, what is Cindy Dollar having? She's a great chef. I'll have what she's having. I'll have what she's having. That's the idea. Father, you know what's best. You've been here before. I'll have what you're having. I'll have what you're having. Not my will be done, your will be done. Not my kingdom, your kingdom come. That's how I want to pray, Lord. I'll have what you're having. And the delight of that obedience, oh, that's incredible. Not that we would just obey, but that it would be something that we long and enjoy doing is obeying our Father's will. Now, I just thought I had a quick little few thoughts on this. Maybe you're thinking, well, man, how do you even know God's will? Like, how do I even know what's happening? Well, of course, we have His word. His revealed will is in His word He's given us. And so you want to know what God's plan is? Well, spend some time in the book. What's that? There's a joke. Put your face in the book, right? That's the Facebook you should be looking at, right? But I thought just quick couple thoughts on how do you know? Well, first think about this. How do you know what to do? Well, if you have this idea of something and you're thinking, is this God's will? Well, is it in agreement with God's word? Is what this idea that you have, you know, like let's say, for instance, I want to move in with my boyfriend. Okay, is this in agreement with God's word? Well, no, it's not. So then that's very easy. That's an easy decision to make. All right, well, okay, if it's in agreement, well, I don't really see anything in there. I want to go to either this college or that college. Okay, it's not really in God's word really where to go to college. Okay, well, then pray. Right? Spend some time in God's word. Just pray. I say, Lord, just reveal this to me. Maybe it's too difficult. Maybe it's too hard. Well, seek some counsel. God's put people around you can talk to and say, Lord, do you think this is God's will for me? What do you think? I'm thinking about this. Go to someone of a maturity, someone that's of deep faith and maturity in Jesus Christ. Seek some counsel. Use some common sense. Right, God's given you a brain. Should I get in debt for $1 million to get this thing? I don't think that's a good idea. I don't know. Use your brain. And then I thought of one, you know, time takes care of many decisions. As time goes on, the door will either open or close. So just wait. And I believe expect circumstances to either confirm or deny what you feel. I believe circumstances will line up one way or the other. And so that's how we can begin to say, okay, Lord, I feel like this is your will. Is it lining up? Are we going on the same track here? Okay, I've been praying. I've been seeking counsel. I've been looking around. It seems like things are kind of lining up in this way. And yeah, all right, man, we're going on the tracks. This is awesome. But at any moment, what happens is that we think it, and then something kind of red flags, and we're like, I don't think so. You know, I'm gonna keep going. I'm not really sure if that was really bad or whatever. Anyway, finding out God's will. Now, we go into the second section of this prayer that Christ describes. We first look upon God, His relationship to us. He's our Father. We understand we have a role to play. We bear His name. Hallowed be Your name in my life. And then we pray, Lord, I want Your rule to reign, not only in the future when You come again, but let it reign in my life right now. And so once you've got that, Jesus says, okay, once you got that, here comes the petitions. Verse 11, a petition for provision. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread, you know, this idea of provision that God provides. Again, only after we've prayed for His name to be hallowed, for His will to be done, for His kingdom to come, then we can begin to say, okay, Lord, here's what's going on. And I have a few things I was thinking about. First, bread. It's so funny that He would say, give us this day our daily bread. Bread. Bread's like so basic, right? Like you get it for free at restaurants. Unless you're like saying no carb and you say no bread for me, but they bring it out anyway. Like, oh, I don't want to waste. You know, I gotta eat it. I think the idea is bread. There's nothing. It's so basic. I really believe And commentators, they got so many ideas on this. And I really believe the plain thing is the main thing. Give us this day our daily bread. I think Jesus is saying, listen, there's nothing too small to ask God for. You need bread? Ask God for bread. It's the most basic food element, bread. And I think sometimes we think, you know what, Lord, my life, I don't have too many, it's not that much an emergency, really. It's not really an emergency. Ah, I don't want to bother you. You're like up there doing stuff. And No. Give us this day our daily bread. Bread, just is nothing too small. You know, like if you've ever been on a motorcycle before, as a kid, there's a thing called a governor. The governor is what keeps the throttle from going super fast. And so, like, if it's for my kid, I crank it way down so they can just go as fast as I can run, you know. There's no governors on prayer, right? There's no limitations, only invitation. Give us this day our daily bread. Nothing too small, nothing too big. We can ask it all before God. Give us this day our daily bread. Not only bread, I think about this is basic. Like, just you can go to God for anything. Even though we learned last week, he already knows what we need, right? And we ask not because he needs to know. We ask because it's good for us to ask. But I love this idea. He says, give us this bread, our daily bread. I believe simply we talked about God as our Father. He just wants to hear from you. Give us this day our daily bread. He just wants to hear your voice. Daily, I really think there's a strong correlation there between the manna in the desert. You know, the manna would have to be collected every single day. Remember? And then the manna would not last but a day, right? If you collected too much manna, the next day it was rotten. And I thought, here's a little correlation there. Give us this day our daily bread. Our prayers should be daily. As though, as Israel, every day had to get up and get manna, every day we need to be people of prayer. As MC Hammer would say, you got to pray just to make it today, right? Throw that in there, Reverend MC Hammer. You guys didn't know that. And I think that it's got to be daily. We got to say, all right, every day, I want to be a man of prayer. I want to be a woman of prayer. And then the manna wouldn't last but a day. And I thought, this speaks for prayer. We can never give up on prayer. I thought about this idea. How often, how many times have maybe you prayed for your husband, you prayed for your father, you prayed for your boss? On one hand, there's no expiration date on prayer, right? It doesn't not last the next day, but have you prayed it again today? Have you continued to pray for your brother? Have you continued to pray for your spouse? Have you continued to pray for your neighbor? Man, Jesus says, give us this day our daily bread. Lord, I'm going to daily depend upon you. I'm going to daily talk to you. I'm going to even repeat the request I repeated yesterday because I know you never tire of me telling you about it. Give us this day our daily prayer. Nothing too small, nothing too big. He wants to hear from us. Jesus, of course, had this habit, right? We've talked about it before. His keystone habit of Jesus, the habit that hinged everything else about his life, was that he was a man of solitary prayer. Often in we'd hear him going off by himself to just pray and commune with his Father. Give us this day our daily prayer, a prayer of provision. Next, a prayer and petition of pardon. Look at verse 12. And forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. I thought this was so strange. Why pray, forgive me of my sins if I've already been forgiven? Why would Christ have me pray this? Forgive me of my debts. Forgive us of our debts as we forgive our debtors. Or forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Why? Well, I think on one hand, I think Christ wants to make sure when we approach God, we recognize our deep need. You know what I mean? We are sinners in need of a Savior. We come before him indebted. Right? Forgive us our debts. We, Father, have sinned against you. And we need forgiveness. And we come before you humbly. saying, Lord, we are weak and we are sinners. And yet on one hand, you'd say, well, this is a prayer for believers. Haven't we already been forgiven of our sin? Well, there's two types of forgiveness, right? Judicial and relational. Judicial and relational. Judicial forgiveness is this idea of what we believe upon the cross, right? We owed this debt to God. God drew a line in the sand and said, don't cross this line. And we're like, all right, boom, and we're crossing it, right? And we sin. We do things that displease God. We say things that displease God. We think things that displease God, and our sin carries a debt to it. The wages of sin is death. And so we've racked up this debt to God through our sin. And so that's why we love the cross as Christians. We love what Jesus Christ did, that Jesus upon the cross would pay a debt he did not owe because we owed a debt we could not pay. All right, that's the judicial forgiveness. When you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're now your debt has been canceled out, right? Been nailed to the cross. We've been forgiven. We think about Colossians 1:14. He's delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, right? So the blood of Christ forgives us of the past, the present, the future sins. Man, we're washed white as snow. It's incredible, but there's relational forgiveness. There's relational forgiveness, right? I mean, I'm going to always be the son of my father. But there's things that I can do that can mar that relationship. I'll always be his son, but there's some times when we're going to be in disfellowship, right? There's going to be times when like maybe we're not really jiving because of my sin. And so there's some relational forgiveness that needs to take place. And so when Christ says, forgive us of our debts, he's talking about relational there, I believe. Forgive us of our debts. We've been forgiven on the cross, but you know what? Is there things in your life that have marred your relationship with him? Are there things in your life that you need to confess and say, Lord, I know I've been forgiven, but you know what? We were walking like this, and I decided to kind of take off on this way. And so, Lord, would you forgive me? I confess, you know, it's hard to bring healing to things that are concealed, right? Things that are hidden can't be helped. So Christ says, hey, when you pray, say, Lord, forgive me of my debts. Lord, I know that I am a son and daughter of the King, but Lord, I've messed up. And I've wandered away. And I ask, would you, I want to be right in communion with you again. Right? The union with God will not be broken. We're sons, we're bought with the blood, but communion could, relationship, fellowship could be. So Christ says, hey, when you pray, Father, forgive me, right? Forgive me. And the longer it takes for you to confess, the harder it gets to do it, right? And so that's why we should be daily praying, Lord, daily, today. Oh, man, today it was hard. Would you forgive me today? Would you come and cleanse me today? And then the even harder part is Jesus says, so ask God for forgiveness. And then you need to forgive those that are in debt to you. If you were here on Sunday, we talked about forgiveness a little bit with Joseph. That's a lot harder to do. Thank you, Lord, for forgiving me, but I'm never going to forgive that guy. Right? As we pray before the Father, we got to say, Lord, God wants forgiveness for you, and he wants forgiveness to flow through you as well. And so he says, when you pray, Father, forgive me of my debts. Help me forgive those that are indebted to me, you know. And do you harbor bitterness? Do you hold grudges? Do you insist on your rights? Right? We often, I've said before, we want grace for ourselves, but justice for everybody else. How many times you've been on the freeway and you see someone pulled over, you're thinking, that's right, man, get that guy. Clean up these streets. You know, but when it's you, oh man, that was a mistake. These people were messing me up. I had my blinkers on. My kids are crazy. You know, we always want grace for us, but justice for everybody else. And so, Jesus says, hey, you gotta be able to forgive those around you, man. You gotta be able to do that. And I think if we think about the cross, Calvary stands as this ultimate demonstration of selflessness, right? If Christ would have insisted on his rights, insisted that he was wrongly accused, we would never have the cross. But he didn't do that. In fact, you remember what he said. As he's being crucified, he yells, Father, forgive them. They don't even know what they're doing. And it's a sign of a true follower of Christ when you can forgive other people. Because if you can't, do you really recognize what God has done for you? This is what Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones says. Whenever I see myself before God, and I realize something of what my Lord has done for me at Calvary, I am ready to forgive anybody anything. The degree to which I'm able to and willing to forgive others is a clear indication to the extent to which I have personally experienced God's forgiveness in my own life, right? So Jesus says, hey, when you pray that. Then finally, he prays for a petition for protection, verse 13. And then he says, do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one, right? You guys know God never tempts us, right? God might test to draw out gold from us. Satan is the one that tempts because he wants to devour us. You guys know this verse, James 1, verse 13. Let no one say when he's tempted, I'm tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anybody else. But each one is tempted when he's drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Psalm 23 tells us that he leads me in the paths of righteousness, right? What this tells me, I believe, is we have a real enemy, right? Deliver us from the evil. We have a real enemy, literal Satan, who is out there like a lion seeking whom he may devour. John 10 tells us that he is out to steal our joy, to kill us, and to destroy our future. And so we need protection. We need protection. We're vulnerable. Just as you would maybe have to wear a helmet to do something extreme, we need protection. Ephesians 6, the armor of God, look it up, pray it out, put it on. We need protection, but the thing is we have a deliverer. That's what I love about this. Jesus says, don't lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. We have a deliverer, Christ, who is greater than he who is in the world. David would say in Psalm 18, the Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer. He rescues. He rescues. And we need to be aware of Satan's schemes. But he who is in us is greater than he who is in the world. We pray for protection. When you're walking with God, you hear his voice. Isaiah 30, 21 says this, your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. Satan is out there. He loves to tempt. He loves to draw us away. He loves to dangle desires in front of us. And we need to say, Lord, lead me not in that way. Lead me in the path of righteousness. May I walk with you. May I keep a short account with you. May I be in communion with you. May I hear your voice saying, this is the way, would you walk in it? And the last conclusion, most would say this last phrase, even though it's so powerful, it's incredible, most would say it's not really a part of the original prayer that Jesus described to his disciples. It was later kind of added. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. I mean, what a way. It's like a praise sandwich, you know, this whole thing. It begins with praise, it ends with praise, has the petitions in the middle, an incredible prayer. And I hope, as I mentioned, man, we've got to kind of come up to a close here. We have so much left, and I hope that in some way this prayer has become a guide. You can think about it now as you, in your prayer life, can navigate through some areas. Maybe it has become a gateway, opening up some different avenues. Wow, to think about praying, God, my Father, I can't wait to think about that some more and pray about that and to think about relationship and hallowing be his name. Wow, I hope it's opened up your mind to an infinite way of which we can pray. And this evening, we're just going to close with the prayer team's going to come forward and we're going to worship just a few moments. And maybe you're here this evening, and as I kind of boldly mentioned, you can't call him Father unless you're his child.
And you can't be his child unless you received him as Lord and Savior. Maybe that's you here this evening. Come up and talk to me or someone else on their prayer team about receiving Christ as Lord and Savior. We'd love to do that with you. Father, we thank you for this evening. We pray that your word would go deep into our hearts. Thank you for just this prayer we get to walk through. We ask now as we close, Jesus, that as we pray, as we meditate, you'd speak to our hearts. Lord, if there's anybody here that's really wondering, Lord, what is your will for me? How can I pray your will be done? I don't know what it is. I pray you speak to them. You would confirm it in their hearts, Lord. We have your word. We have great godly counsel. Lord, I pray that you would just maybe confirm some decisions, maybe even here at this place this evening. We love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Prayer team's going to come up. We'll pray for a few moments.